See, God has given us life. And this life, we are only through the grace of Jesus Christ. Even the unbelievers, even the people that deny God, even the people that don't recognize Him, they owe their life and their being to the grace of Jesus Christ. At the same very moment, God has given us a path, a law, a way that we should go, so that it can be good for us and can be good for everybody. And this is why God encourages we to be faithful. Faithful to what? Let's go to a few Bible verses. I'm not here to teach you or to preach on you. I just want to remind you some Bible verses so that we can think a little bit about this special way to which God asks us to be faithful. In Revelation chapter 2 verse 10, we read, "Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. Hear that ear, let him hear what the Spirit says into the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death." What it is to be you to be faithful from time to time. Another thing is you to be faithful even unto death and continuously. It's really a serious thing you to sacrifice your life to Christ. It's a serious thing you to lose your life. But it's much more serious you to live for Christ and to be faithful. And this is why Revelation tells us that be faithful unto death. There is no alternative to faithfulness. The good thing is that Christ is always with us. Now, there is the one promise which sometimes we neglect in this verse, in verse 10. He that overcomes shall not be hurt of the second death. We often emphasize Christ as our Savior and as a benefactor of our salvation in a way that He's going to take us into heaven, and then we're going to experience the bliss and the beauty and the communion with Him and with all the angels and with all our friends and relatives. But we sometimes miss that Christ also saved us from the second death. And let me tell you, second death is not a picnic. Second death has nothing to do with the first death. You see, the people that have to experience the second death, they don't have Savior, you know that? They don't have Savior, and if you don't have Savior, God's law stands in front of you. And you need to pay for every single transgression you did, and I did, for all my life. And we know very well, Romans 6, 23, the wages of sin is death. Now, one thing is you to sin once and to die once. But you committed through your 70 years old life maybe 30,000 sins. The law must be satisfied. A such a death must be invented for the sinner that can satisfy the law completely. And do you understand now why? Only Christ can save us. All of this multitude of sins that the law have to be satisfied with can be taken only by the one that can carry them. Are you with me? Only one that can carry them can take all of this. Imagine 7 billion people. By another 7 billion, maybe live through the 6,000 years. Maybe 20 billion people, 20 billion sinners. Amplify this by 20,000 sins. How much? Wow, vast number. And do you know when the salvation plan was introduced to the universe? All the angels fall down before Christ and says, "Let me be a substitute for the fallen man." Do you know what Christ said? Even the life of angel is not sufficient to cover for the all sins committed. And this is why the Ellen G. White in the earlier writing says, "I saw some people die instantly at that very sad moment. And I saw some dying for days, suffered for days, until the law was fully satisfied. And the last of all," do you know who was the last of all? Satan himself. Because he had to pay for the sins not only for his own sins, but for the sins of the redeemed. Because if you remember Leviticus chapter 16, all the sins are confessed on the God Azazel. And it was sent in the desert. So he had to carry the sins, the punishment of the sins of the redeemed. This is why whatever he started, he will finish it. So it's a serious matter, you to be redeemed from the second day. And we must every single moment of our life be thankful that we don't have to pass there, because Christ passed through the horrors of separation with the Father. And he paid the sins. So the law is satisfied. I'd like to get our thoughts concentrated in a few biblical examples. And one of them is King Asa. King Asa is the third king of the southern kingdom. His grandfather is King Rehoboam, and the King Rehoboam is the son of King Solomon. King Rehoboam turned to be a very weak king, and the Bible says he committed evil because he didn't give his heart to God. King Abijah also, his son. Now comes the grandfather of King Rehoboam, and that's King Asa. King Asa started very well. If you read actually the report in 1 Kings chapter 15, you will see it's a brilliant king. It's a brilliant king. It's one of the best kings ever. He says he committed such a good things. But the Bible doesn't finish there. We've got a parallel passage which we read in 2 Chronicles chapters 14 to 16. And there he also started with the good deeds of King Asa. You know, King Asa first says, look now, if I have to be secure from all the invaders, I need to establish my fortresses. And while he had a peace, he built his fortresses. Then after, he took his mother, queen, thought that she can't be a queen because she had some idol worship as well. Then something else happened. Zara, the Cushite, that's Africa, comes with 1 million forces, 1 million troops, all right? King Asa had 300,000 troops from Judah and 280,000 from Benjamin. So it's approximately 1 to 2. And then he prayed. The spirit of prophecy says to us that every Christian should learn the prayer of King Asa at this very moment. And King Asa prayed and he says, God, for you is nothing to help with many or with less. And we should learn that lesson as well, when the trouble is too big in our life. And God intervened, and the Africans were defeated. All the Ethiopians, Libyans, Kushites, whatever forces can Zara take, went through to fight with us. He defeated them. Then he deposited Queen Maaka, the daughter of Absalom. He deposited her to be a queen. He made a reformation all around. And if King Asa died at this very moment, we may be with any one day ever. But this is why the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 11, all these things has written for us so that can be an example for us. This is not written so that we can read it like a newspaper and to finish it. This is given as an example for us. And the example, it's a warning example. What happened next? It's a sad story. King Baasha of the Northern Kingdom made a preparation for war against Asa. Look, we read in 1 Timothy 3, verse 12. If you want to read, live a righteous life, will be persecuted. God's people always will be under attack because the devil is not happy with them. So King Baasha attacked God's people and to want to destroy them. Now, at this very moment, instead of relying on God, he started playing diplomacy. He went to the King Benadad and, Benadad. He went to King Benadad and made a contract with him. And to secure the contract, He took all the church treasury, all the treasury of the temple, and gave it to the king, to the pagan king. By the way, King Rehoboam, his grandfather, when he departed from God, you remember, Solomon in the temple had golden shield with pure gold. They didn't last much. When King Rehoboam fell from grace, Pharaoh Shishak came from Egypt and took them off. No more gold. Now the gold is diminishing even more by the unfaithfulness of the guardian and the custodian of God's people, King Asa. Now the prophet comes there and warns him and says, King Asa, you're not doing right. Do you know what he says to the prophet? He oppresses him. He's angry with the prophet. Who are you to dare to give His Majesty advice? Who are you? He oppresses the prophet. He oppresses even more righteous people at this very moment. Now, you know, sometimes God in His mercy sent us something that we can stumble. And in His mercy, He sent us a sickness. He had a sickness, He says, the Bible says, He is sick in His feet. But again, instead of this to make him turn to God, the Bible says he turned only to the physicians, only to the doctors. He forget God. There is no more God. He tried to get help only with the physicians. And then he died. Look, the Bible of the spirit of prophecy doesn't tell us is it going to be in heaven or not. But look now, of your way of life has been to forget God and to leave Him out, and this has been your experience, it is very unlikely that you're going to see King Asa. But why I'm saying this to you, except my daughter and my wife, we are all people that we are past our half-life. It is very important we to be faithful at this very moment, because even a life of service and good deeds cannot compensate if we depart from God. We often quote the example of the thief on the cross, as in the last moment he received pardon for Christ, and the spirit of prophecy clearly says, yes, he's going to be there, near to Christ. But don't forget Judas. Judas was one of the 12. And if Judas died before Christ entered in Jerusalem, we wouldn't know what happened. But the divine providence gives us His history. So it cuts both ways. Whatever is good for the goose is good for the gander, as the saying goes. Okay? You know this man? Anybody for the guess? This man?
You know.
Kellogg. John Harvey Kellogg. If you eat cornflakes, it's due to him. Also, he got a big, impart how to prepare peanut butter and many other things. He lived a very, very ripe life. He was born in 1852 and he died in 1943. 91 years old. Look, if there was a good man on this earth, I can't remember more good than this one. Do you know how many children eat at this table every day? 42 adopted children. He didn't have children on his own. He was too busy with God's work. He had a wife. He had a family. 42 children adopted. Do you know how much money this man gave to church? Do you know what is his contribution to the Adventist movement as such? But this story doesn't finish here. Do you know what happened? He got some funny ideas. And Ellen G. White warned him. The president of General Conference, Spicer, also warned him. And he got a meeting with Spicer. Sorry, I've got the accent. Do you get through my accent, or I'm speaking too fast? Or it's too hot, Jeff? Do you get through it? Because what I'm going to say next is very important. They got a discussion with Spicer. And Kellogg says to Spicer, Spicer is the General Conference president. Spicer comes there to win Kellogg back, because Kellogg starts turning away from the right way. He's not faithful unto death, as we read in Revelation 2:10. So now what is happening? Kellogg asks Spicer. Spicer, tell me, where is heaven? And Spicer says to him, heaven is the middle point of God's creation, the ruling commandment point of universe. Not Spicer. Heaven is where God is. True or false? Tell me. True or false?
True.
Half true. And I'll tell you now why it's half true. And that truth are very dangerous. Then it carries on. It makes a classical syllogism. It makes a classical trap. Not all syllogisms are traps, but this is a trap. Then you ask him, if heaven is there where God is God everywhere or not? Yes, God is everywhere. So it means, what is the conclusion? If heaven is where God is, and God is everywhere, that means heaven is everywhere. Do you see the false? Do you see the false? This is a conclusion made by false statements. Do you see the fallacy? And then he says like this, is God with you? Spicer says yes. Is it in your heart? Yes, I believe so. That means you're holy. And do you know what is his book? Name of this book? The Living Temple. You're the temple of the living God. And that's not in Rome. It's 1 Corinthians 6 verse 19. The temple of the living God. Now, because of that, you see how subtle is that. You don't need Christ. Because you're already sanctified by the presence of God. Do you see the deception? Now, this book, The Living Temple, was presented for printing. And the General Conference made a commission of 5 people to check it out very carefully, is it good for printing of the Review and Herald print press or not. And the commission came with the conclusion, with the majority of 3-2, and the one that wrote the referat was Alonso Jones. Do you remember Jones? 1888. Justification by faith, Jones and Warner. And the Jones said, there is nothing wrong with the book. She is perfect. But the book is pantheistic and the book denies Christ. But miracle happens and the General Conference, instead of accepting the opinion of the majority, accepted the opinion of the minority and decided not to print the book. Because some of the members of the General Conference decided that no, there is a blasphemy of God and there is a pantheism there. But a letter comes from Dr. Kellogg to the Review and Herald Press. Print my book, I want 5,000 copies. And the day, you know which is the day? It's the 13th of December, 1902. Now, at the same night, the press is set up. The most beautiful and expensive luxury paper is set up there. All the letters are set up. All the calls, everything is set up to do it. Do you know what happens? Same night. Don't confuse this fire with the fire of 18th February. 10 months earlier. This is a fire of the sanitarium. This is another fire now. Fire for the press, Review and Herald. Alright? His book was burned. He managed to print it later on. Still. And it came into circulation. But what I want to say to you, see how righteous men like a Wagner fall down, Jones fall down, Dr. Keller fall down, King Asa fall down. Your past ministry and my past ministry is not guarantee of our future success and the future approval. This is why God says, be faithful unto death. And all this will finish, actually. So time is finished. When I say to the righteous that he shall surely live, if he trusts in his own righteousness, we read in Ezekiel chapter 36, famous chapter. If he trusts in his own righteousness and commit iniquity, all his righteousness shall not be remembered, but for his iniquity that he committed shall die for it. All the righteous deeds that you did, even your forgiven sins, if you turn from God and forget to be faithful, you don't have Savior. Now you have to pay for the sins that have been forgotten in the past as well. Whatever said is simply because you don't have a savior. It is finished. Do you understand now why we need the Christ daily? Daily, every second of our life. Not because of the fact that he is savior of us since in the past, but also that if we don't have Christ, we don't have savior, and we are exposed to the whole wrath of God, which Christ put on himself. But it's not all sad story. This is why we've got this is why we've got Christ, and this is what is power. And the advice of 2 Corinthians 13 verse 5, he says, examine yourself every day. Test yourself. Are you in Christ or not? Examine yourself. Look, I don't say concentrate on yourself. The Bible says, Hebrews 12 verse 2, look up to Christ, the beginner and the finisher of our faith. We need to look up at Christ. But Paul doesn't contradict himself when he says, examine yourself. Because it's very important. Whatever happened in 1902, there is no guarantee that it's not going to happen today. And I can tell you that it's happening. In local and in global. And it's going to be like a whirlwind. And it's going to pass very quick. And we need to be ready. We need to be faithful. God has promised us his power. And he says, I will keep in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusted in me. Trust in the Lord forever, for in the Lord Jehovah is everlasting. That's his promise. And I would like a specific promise for the people over 70. If anybody is over 70, this promise is for you. Look at it. That's from Reflecting Christ, page 163. The afternoon sun of life may be more mellow and productive of fruit than the morning sun. It may continue to increase in size and brightness until it drops behind the western hills. Keep your heart and mind young by continuous exercise. Exercise your faith, exercise your body, and exercise your mind. And may God bless us with to be faithful and not to follow these bad examples, but to follow the good examples. Because God says, you'll keep in perfect peace. He whose mind is stayed. And that's my desire for all of us.